Over to you. If you're
And I was muted, of course. So let's see if I can share the screen. Here we go. Can you see it?
I can see it. It's still, it's not in present. I mean,
Yeah,
I can see
now.
all of your slides there, not just the main one.
Yeah, here we go. So basically, thank you to the organizers for inviting me. Basically, this is the talk, the project that gave me the idea to start this idea of making this workshop. So I wanted to present it, even if it's 2 years later. At the time, I was working at Imperial and I got the money from Imperial. Now I'm working at UKHSA. So basically, I don't have to make an introduction on what plasmids are. This feels so nice, so easy. But I wanted to just for a moment focus your attention on the fact that plasmids can be vertically inherited and horizontally inherited, and what this does mean for how fast they can spread. Because of course, vertically inherited spreads really slow because each generation they are inherited, but horizontally inherited can go very fast. And also, we can have conjugative and mobilization plasmids. And the machinery length, and I won't use any other name than machinery because Fernando will not like it, I think. It changed. And okay, I was just pointing out this. Also, I don't have to tell you that plasmid dynamics is not so simple, so they can inherit pieces from everywhere. But I like this image, so I wanted to show you. So the original question in this project was, how much do horizontal and vertical inheritance contribute to the spread of antimicrobial resistance? And the approach was basically comparative phylogenetics that tried to relate the evolution of a host bacterium, the plasmid, and the antibiotic resistant genes contained in the plasmid. The really cool thing that I think hasn't had enough relevance, the relevance that it needed to have, and that maybe some of you will want to use this data set, it's 116 plasmids sequenced from 97 host E. colis. And the cool thing is that they were sampled from human and animal, and from both pathogenic and commensal bacteria. And that they were spanning a lot of different, as you see here in the pie chart, ESBL resistance alleles. Let's call them alleles. Also, the other interesting thing that I put here on perspective on the on perspective, so is that these plasmid or these E. coli samples were sampled from a very long between very long for plasmids, very long time frame. So there were three that in the end resulted to be just one E. coli from the Murray collection, and then some quite a lot that were sampled before. Extended spectrum beta-lactamases resistances appeared. That was in the 90s. The other cool thing about this data set is that it's extremely well sequenced. So they were sequenced because it's a very old data set. They were sequenced with the 454, so it's long sequence. And some of them, the long ones, I think, were electroporated out and then put in the K12 and then sequenced with the K12. So there was not a problem whatsoever in reconstructing the plasmid, because when there was something, when there were ends in the sequence, Katrin, who is the main author everywhere in this paper, went and sequenced all the gaps. So you can trust these sequences in any way possible. And she also annotated them manually. I mean, there was an automatic pipeline, but then she checked every single gene manually and every single non-coding space if there was a gene that the automatic annotation was missing. So it's a really well-sequenced data set, and you can find and download it if you need it for anything you want to try. The problem at that point was that we had the MLSPs, and so we could reconstruct the host bacterium tree. Then we could in silico isolate the antibiotic resistant gene and use it to build the tree. But the problem was, what's the plasmid tree like? Because of course, the ideas we had was like, if the plasmid tree is more similar to the host bacterial tree, then the plasmid is mainly vertically inherited. Was similar. So if it's different, there is significant plasmid conjugation among bacteria. At the same time, if the plasmid tree is very similar to the antibiotic resistant tree, then it means that the antibiotic resistance stays in the plasmid and it's just the plasmid that conjugates. While if the tree is different, horizontal transfer of genes, of resistant genes, is happening heavily among the plasmids. So the problem was how to build the plasmid tree. Because we didn't have any one single gene that encompassed the whole data set. So there was no way of building a tree with the entire data set. So we needed to resort to subtrees. But how did we obtain the most informative and reliable subtrees possible? So informative meaning, including as many plasmids as possible so that we could reconstruct a nice history, and reliable meaning these trees relied on as many genes as possible, because of course you couldn't use just one gene that is shared among most of the plasmids, but then it's not so reliable. And then I came out with this data-driven network that is kind of inspired faintly by network theory to build the most informative and reliable subtree possible. First, I describe the method and then I show the graph. The method is called giant component analysis and is a standard analysis in network theory. And so I started from a very strict threshold for defining shared genes between plasmid, which meant that I blasted them with a very strict E value. Then I computed the Jaccard distance between plasmids in terms of shared gene. So the Jaccard distance is 1 minus the percentage of shared genes. And the shared genes, probably is too much, is the number of shared genes divided the total number of genes present in both plasmids. And then for each threshold, for different thresholds in Jaccard distance, I determined, but there is a command in a graph, the Jaccard distance, I determined the size of the biggest connected component of plasmids. And this is the graph that you obtain, and you are looking at the purple dotted line. So what are you seeing here? In the left-hand side, so towards one, we are connecting plasmids even if they share one single gene. And we end up with a totally connected network of plasmids. And we connect all of them, even if they share all different genes. On the left-hand side, sorry, I have a problem with left and right, we are connecting the different plasmids if they share almost all the genes. And there, as you can see, we manage to connect very few of them, and most of them stay there as singletons. And this is really, you don't get any way of telling a history of the evolution of this plasmid. The thing is that if you now focus on the purple line, you would expect it to raise nicely from 0 to 100, while, as you can see, it's almost flattish, and then it jumps altogether. And this is suggestive, as similar, of a process in network theory that is called the percolation. And you don't expect this to happen everywhere. It's something, it's a peculiar process, and it tells you something about the dataset characteristics. And what we think this is telling us is that up to a certain point, which is here, you have information. So you connect plasmids, and the genes that you are using to connect these plasmids are actually signal of a shared evolution. While from there on, you connect plasmids just because for the restricted probably size of the common pan plasmidome, they end up picking the same gene, but it does not contain any evolutionary information on that, or evolutionary information. So once we choose the threshold here, we draw a graph connecting the plasmids. So here, the shapes are, if they are mobilized, the rounds are mob and the squares are conjugative. And the stars are, the circles, the stars, and the triangles are different types of mob, while all the squares are conjugative. And when you color them by the AMR gene that they share, you clearly understand that they are not clustering by antimicrobial resistance. While now that we connected the edges, we colored the edges by their incompatibility group, you see that it's more like it that they are sharing, that they are connecting by the incompatibility groups. Which is, in a sense, not so surprising, because for conjugative plasmids, the incompatibility groups are big. But the thing is that this paired with the percolation-like signal, it's kind of telling us that something else that I have still to figure out completely. So in the end, I was able, I isolated, here is just an example. I isolated the genes that made the clustering, and I was able to build the host bacteria tree, the plasmid tree, and the antibiotic resistant gene tree. And here, if you look at the red samples, which are always the same, you see that while in the antibiotic resistant gene tree, they cluster all together, in the plasmid tree, two cluster and one is on the other side. And in the host bacteria tree, they are everywhere. So these trees don't resemble, they resemble at all. So the thing is, here in this data set, we have high mobility of plasmid among bacteria, but also high mobility of antibiotic resistant genes among plasmids. And now I wanted to finish with some thing that I thought before, but then after today's talk, I think it makes a lot of sense to discuss it with you. So I thought, we all started this method by matching genes for similarity in sequence. And the implicit assumption in this matching for similarity in sequence is that since the data set spans a short time frame, I mean, if you think of the distance between human and chimp or whatever, this is less than 50 years. But also the plasmid is short, so you cannot expect too many mutations in properly vertically inherited plasmid or genes. And so the more similar they are, the more likely they are to be vertically inherited. And therefore, they are useful to tell us the story of the evolution of these plasmids. But are all these genes that are used for the plasmid tree vertically inherited? But most probably not. And were some of them lost and reacquired? I think most probably yes. And then, can we define, or is this method a good way to define, I don't know, a local in time and plasmid type, characteristic core plasmidome that we can trust that is mostly vertically inherited? Or should we give up the idea of using tree-based, of building trees based on molecular evolution to tell the plasmid evolutionary history? And we should instead develop methods based on gene gain loss, which seems to be what most of the people talking today are trying to do or are aiming to do. But then the thing that puzzles me, and on which maybe you can help me understand, is that the phylogenetics works so well because there is an intrinsically random process at the base of it. So like the mutation happened randomly. It's a fair assumption to assume that mutations are happening randomly. And my question is, do we understand enough of the biological mechanisms that have plasmid gain and loss gene so that we can develop a properly reliable model that we can use? Because most of the methods we saw today are very good at defining the plasmid, the tree, like the shape of the tree. But phylogenetic does not only consist in the shape of the tree, but also in a time frame. So it's timing the tree. So yeah, I want to leave you with this question. And nothing, this is the people who worked on this project and the paper is down here. And that's all.
That was a fantastic way to end the day, Alice. That was great. And lots of interesting questions for us. It's a bit odd separating questions from this talk from the general discussion, but let's do it. Have we got any immediate questions for Alice before we open up for a wider discussion?
Everybody's sleeping.
I'm sure they're not sleeping. They're stunned. Hold on. Oh, no, sorry, that's for Liam, so I'll say that. I think you raised the key thing, which is that we got lucky with, you know, SNPs and species chromosomes, see what I mean? Because it looked, you know, you can model things with a ticking clock.
Yeah.
And the differences that we're seeing between plasmids, I don't believe that there's anything clock-like in there. So it seems to me unlikely that we're going to build models which directly correlate with time, with the events that we're seeing. Please, anyone, if they disagree, please just feel free to talk. So I think we might need to use these models to infer slightly different things than what we're doing with standard phylogenetic trees. I also think, as Liam suggested at the end of his talk, we could really do with more longitudinal data. If anyone's got 25 years to spare and they want to start a long-term evolution experiment of plasmids, I'd be very happy to send a supporting letter.
But then people argue that like Lenski's evolution experiment is an experiment and you cannot translate it into like clinical.
Sure.
Or like,
sure, but I'd rather have some data than no data.
Yes, of course.
I mean, anybody else want to pipe up? No, we're the only two opinionated people here. I find that hard to believe.